This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Somewhere South in Sonora, A Novel. Author: Will Levington Comfort. Year: 1925. Topic: Prologue: Old Lights of the Rio Brava. 1. Bob Leadley moved toward the sound of guitars. The strumming came from over the stream where the Mexicans had their own little cantina and their dobe huts. Back from the damask cheek, which was the palpitating core of the white settlement, voices of the miners reached him, not loud tonight, not uproarious. Things were seldom duller than now on the Rio Brava, shrunken to a trickle at this time of year. The eke of gold had been at its lowest for days on the placers. A hot, still August night in Bismo, Arizona, the night that changed one white man all around. Mexican figures bowed to him. A woman laughingly called from a darkened doorway, "Buenas noches, señor." Another laughed from behind her, adding somewhat wistfully, "Hace un calor sofocante." He walked on past the dobe huts and onto the mesa. He heard the coyotes, different from any time before. There was no moon and the stars were indistinct, run together in the heat haze. Bob Leadley took off his hat. Drops of sweat held by the tight hatband dropped down on his face. He had to laugh at himself, the feelings that rolled and tumbled over each other within. Nobody would have believed it of him, feelings to keep a secret of. It was as if someone he had always been waiting for had come to town, not yet seen, a friend or enemy he couldn't tell, but a life or death meaning to the arrival. Running steps reached him from behind, a panting voice calling, "Bob! Bob!" "Hello, Mort," he answered as the other came up, the tone so quiet and cool it was almost whimsical. "What you doing away off here?" "She didn't want me there." "It's a boy, Bob, only?" "I thought as much." "It's a boy, all right, only she, they say she ain't going to live." The mother was already dead, but this was Mort Cotton's way of softening the shock for a friend. The same easy tone answered, "Guess we'd better walk back." "I wouldn't hurry if I was you, Bob. I'll run back if you like and get the rest of the word." It was her doings that they called the child Bart, after some saint of her religion. She had a lot of saints, one for every day or so, a Spanish woman, and she hadn't asked much, come to think of it. The oddest thing Bob Leadley had ever done was to marry her. He never would have thought better of it, except it made a difference in the town. It would make more of a difference now, leaving a boy with her blood in his veins. They wouldn't call it Spanish blood in Bismo. Mexicans weren't held high on this side of the border. Queer little bird-like ways she had, little vanities and secrets, always shrinking farther indoors in daylight, always more alive in the nighttime. She had sung and cooked and washed for him, pleasant to be with, but he never really knew her. She was like ripe fruit that couldn't last, pleasant to the taste and pretty to look at, but nothing much for real hunger. Come and gone with her curious ways, her brightenings up in the dark, only asking one thing, that the boy be called after this particular one of her saints, and Bart was as good a name as any. So there was a gray-eyed white man in Bismo, Arizona, with a black-eyed boy in his cabin. No problem about it at all, from the standpoint of the other miners, just scorn. Only Bob Leadley had been known from away back as cool and gamey as they made them, nothing like the squaw man, cholo man type. The miners couldn't give much play to their contempt before those pleasant gray eyes of Bob's, which might inquire their meaning and look into it. Men weren't mind readers in Bismo. They saw the steady eyes, the whimsical smile, but no one knew what was going on. Not even Mort Cotton, who had punched cattle, skinned mules, and washed for gold with Bob Leadley for 10 years, not even the Mexican woman and her daughter who brought Bart up. But it was all a matter of how you gave advice. Bismo found out gradually that Bob wasn't set up very high in his idea of being a successful parent. They found he listened attentively to comment given within a certain range of tones. Discovering this, the miners supplied it plentifully. The social barrier in Bismo was the river itself. Mexican laborers worked 2 to 1 to the white men in the placers, but the two settlements rarely mixed outside working hours, except when waves of drink inundated the white miners. Then they would move over to Dobytown to drink and eat different, the calls ending in a row, not infrequently in the death of a greaser. Lechi Welton, the town marshal, wasn't even to be approached on a matter like this, and sounds of mourning from one or more dobe huts seldom reached as far as the damask cheek, any more than the strumming of guitars. Several times in the next dozen years, Bob Leadley and Mort Cotton were on the point of leaving Bismo, but the Rio Brava had a way of suddenly picking up, the gold eek rising to quite a little color. There was another thing. It was hard for Bob to make up his mind to take Bart away from the Mexican woman and her daughter. It didn't seem fair. The old señora had been a friend of Bart's mother, and loved the white man's boy, also her daughter loved him. But Bart was growing up more Mexican than white, talked Spanish in preference to English, was more often seen across the stream than on this side, and running with the Mexican boys, one Palto especially, than with the 4 or 5 white boys of his age in town. Bart's whole business was horses, but Mexican words having to do with them were too easy on his tongue. Hondos, latigos, riatas, conchos, yakimas. A slim, black-haired youth, slow to rouse, not cruel or a fool, an easy way with him, not stirred in the least by the thought of washing gold, no idea of working hours as being superior to all others. Just to see Bart leaning against the doorway, on his feet but relaxed in a way no white boy could stand, a guitar in his hand, perhaps, had a way of filling his father with a revulsion that Bob had to take out to the mesa to quiet. It was as if the man saw the face of his boy under a high-tinted sombrero, instead of the cast-off cavalryman's campaign hat with a Copley peak, as if a sash of seda were thrust back over the shoulder. Bob didn't quite know it, but it was because he was seeing Bart with the eyes of the other miners at these times that he was stung so. The town had put a secret fear on him that his boy was not showing up white. The father lacked one thing that parents usually have to work with. He didn't have the sense of being right at all times. Once or twice he felt so sure of himself that he treated Bart to a whipping, which the boy took without a murmur, minding pain no more than an Indian. He never explained. The father got one of the starts of his life to find he had whipped Bart for a thing he didn't do, the boy not taking the trouble to clear himself. Bob's feeble sense of rightness was shaken by that. It about all went out of him, and something else with it. The deep hurt of it was that Bart held no grievance afterward. A master at letting other men alone, Bob couldn't keep his thoughts and his willpower off the boy. He made up for his rare rough periods by being lenient. All the time his actions and reactions brought advice from his fellow townsmen. It was Lechi Welton, the town marshal, who started the saying that Bart wouldn't live to be hanged. All this time Bob Leadley's eyes were the most lighthearted anywhere. As a male parent, I'm considerable of a botch, I admit that, he would say, in a way to delude anybody that he ever suffered real care, and at the same time there was a sorrow burning at the center of him like a red lamp. Often at work on the placer, he knew a loneliness to get close to his boy. He might have seen Bart at breakfast, but that made no difference. He felt lonely for him more than once when they were in the same room together. 2. Bart was past 12 when he was missing for a day or two and rode back into town on a gray rat-tailed pony that was raked from shoulder to crupper with fresh wounds and old scars. Lechi Welton, in the capacity of deputy sheriff, halted him at the edge of town, looking the outfit over. Where did you get that briskut? Over at the cup queue. Did you do all that fresh hookin' on his hide? No. Buy him. No, they didn't want him much over at the rancho. Said I could have him for sitting 30 seconds. And you did? Yep, more. I ain't got off. Lechi Welton looked queer, and rode back to the placers where he found Bob Leadley. Your kids just brought in a man-killer from the cup queue, a gray rat-tail I remember seeing over there. If I was you, Bob, I'd put a bullet in the head of that cayuse, and I'd leave off work and do it now before he kicks a hole out of Bart's face or eats his scalp off. Letchy Welton went on to recall further details of Rat Tail's reputation, of the fits he threw, the men he had maimed. Bob left the placer and went to his own little corral where he found Rat Tail unsaddled, Bart leaning in the fence shadow, looking over his new possession. "I hear he's an outlaw, Bart. I wouldn't ride him if I was you. I rode him over from the cup queue, all right. I know. He may have been glad to get away from there, but look at him." Bob took a few steps closer to the old gray head, which suddenly looked deformed. A float of baleful red appeared back of the near filmy eye. "I've seen that look once or twice before, Bart, and I'll have to tell you to stay off him. All he knew from the cup queue was Rackin' and Quirtin' Dad. But that ain't the look of a nice hoss. I like him. It ain't the look of a broke hoss, Bart. I don't want no broke hoss. You'll have to stay off, that's all." Bob saw that deep questioning look in the eyes slowly turned his way, no anger, no hate, but separateness, a widening gulf. "At least, stay off him till I try him out for a few days." Bob was sincere in his attempt to make the Rat Tail safe for his son, but the toughest saddle sessions he had ever known followed in the next 10 days. Where the ordinary outlaw left off with sunfish and rail fence, the old gray opened fresh spontaneities. One of the last things he did with Bob Forked was to make a quarter-mile sprint toward a low-hanging cottonwood limb, the idea being to rake off his tormentor, which he carried out. Another time, when Bob persisted several seconds longer than usual, the Rat Tail came out of a buckling snap to fling himself on the ground. The day came when Bob Leadley, cool-eyed, a smile on his lips, would have preferred to stand up and be shot at than mount the gray monster again, but that's what he did, it being his code. That day Rat Tail plunged into a adobe wall and left Bart's father on the inside of a crowded chicken yard with a broken leg. "I should have done what Letchy told me, Bart," Bob said that night. "He ain't a man-killer just, he's a man-eater. You'll have to leave him alone from now on. You tried hookin' him, the way they did over in the cup queue, it makes him crazy. He ain't crazy natural, his mouth's tender. He's been driven crazy. He needs humorin', Dad." Anger flamed up in the father. He had been a horse hand all his life. "I say keep off him from now on." 3 days later, Mort Cotton came into the cabin, his bushy eyebrows showing curiously white. "I hate to tell on the kid, Bob, but it'll get to you anyway," he said. "He's been riding that Rat Tail on a hackamore, he's riding him now. And what I'm getting at is, he ain't having trouble." Bob's face turned to the wall. He had many days to think it out while his leg was in boards. It was disobedience, but had he been right? Didn't Bart have something on the gray others hadn't, with other horses too, perhaps? It wasn't a matter of just sitting a horse. Bob knew without vanity he could do that as well as most men. It was something new, not to be expressed. He had seen the deformed look of the gray's head straighten out as Bart drew near, the red flame of the eye die down. Bart had something on him, a new feel with a horse. "I belong to the old school," he muttered. "All we know is that a hoss has to be broke, that a hoss is ruined that once gets his own way. Bart ain't a part of that. He makes a hoss forget his own way. He gives him his courage back. But it's disobedience. I dasn't let Bart get away with it. They'd think I was crazy if I didn't get rid of the Rat Tail." Mort Cotton took the old outlaw back to the cup queue as a led horse. 3. Finally, the morning, a year or two later, when old Batten, the storekeeper at Bismo, was found murdered by Bob Leadley's serving woman, who had gone over for a can of condensed milk. Her outcry roused the town. The old man had been hammered over the head and pulled out from his own back room, or else he had reached that far before they finished him. Things were spilled. There were sticky tracks on the floor, and a whiny smell in the gray of morning. A cask of apricot brandy in the place, no one knew how old, was still dripping when Bob Leadley got there. He recalled that Batten had never sold any of this brandy, holding it choice, and sending a little flask to anyone who was sick. What struck him queerly, too, was old Batten's thin white hair not combed back as usual. Letchy Welton came in and propped the old man up against the counter for a better look. The marshal's jaw got harder and wider as he repeated that it was a Mexican job. The town was crowding in. Bob Leedley noted that his boy, Bart, was standing around. "Go on back home and get your breakfast, Bart," he said. The whole white settlement was inside or at the store doors by this time. Mort Cotton's voice seemed to find the strangest hush for this sentence. They needn't have killed him. Old Batten would have given them all that they took, at least trusted him for what they took. It sounded so innocent and mournful, but it was like blowing on fire, the effect on the crowd. Everyone was thinking something of the same kind, and a sort of hell took hold and united them, the same contagion that makes a mob. The cask had ceased to drip, not yet 5 in the morning. No one knew how much money Batten had in the place. "A Mexican job," repeated Letchy Welton, his jaw getting harder and whiter. "We'll just go over to Dobytown right now and see who's missing." They routed out the shacks across the river. Two Mexicans, Margarin and Ruetta, couldn't be accounted for. Also a boy called Palto around the diggings was gone. About this time Bob Leedley noticed that Bart hadn't done what he was told, but had come over the stream with the rest. "I told you to get out of here. Go home and wait till I come." Now Bob recollected that Bart and Palto had been thick at times. No work on the mines that day. The damask cheek filled early. 10 men chosen by Letchy Welton took the trail after the 3 Mexicans, a trail that showed clear, 3 ponies headed toward the border, 6 or 7 hours start. All were thinking as they rode of that old white head, 10 men and the marshal still keyed to that sentence which Mort Cotton had spoken. The thoughts of the posse working together this way made the purpose deadly. Each man grew painfully fond of old Batten, and the other side of the fondness was rising hate for the Mexicans ahead. Every little while someone said, "Poor old Batten, he wouldn't have hurt a toad." They were several miles out before Bob Leedley noticed that Bart was overtaking them from behind. At first he thought Bart was bringing a message from the town, but it proved he merely wanted to go. "You turn around and ride back just as fast as you can, young man," the father said. Those were the words which fixed it the other way. "Let him stick. Good chance to see what he's made of," Letchy Welton laughed, just as he would have said, "Send him home," if Bob had asked to let him stay. The next day, the posse was pressing the 3 Mexicans a lot closer. They didn't seem more than 3 hours ahead. It was desert work now, hot and grim. Toward nightfall, they came to a fork where the fugitives had broken apart, 2 turning to the left, 1 to the right. Letchy Welton sent 4 men after the lone pony to the right, and kept on with 7 after the other 2. On the 3rd noon, the 2 Mexicans, hard-pressed, made their final split. This broke up the pursuing party a second time, Letchy Welton, Mort Cotton, Bob Leedley, and Bart keeping on straight south, the other 4 turning east. Toward sundown that 3rd night, over 100 miles from Bismo, only Bart was riding light and easy, his pony with a reserve left, the other 3 horses done for, and their riders as well. Canteens were empty, desert country, here and there a big solitary cactus rising like a shade tree gone crazy. "There's water ahead," Bart told his father. "I can tell by my pony's ears." The lower rim of the sun was out of sight when they came to the Mexican's horse, finished, lying at the edge of a pool of stagnant, coated water, choked in the hollows of a dry stream bed. The man tracks stretched on toward a shadowy mass that proved to be the old hard rock diggings of Red Ante, long since abandoned by any miners, Mexican or white. Letchy yanked up his horse's head from the pool. "Our game's ahead, men. Come on, we'll get him and then come back to this pea soup." Now, entering that deserted town, it was as if Bob Leedley had to see every detail. Not that he wanted to, but there seemed to be a pair of extra clear eyes working back of his regular eyes, though he was partly out of his head from exhaustion. The abandoned street, between the huts of Red Ante impressed him as something perpetual, moment and place. At the same time, a kind of insane anger was in his brain, because he had to hold up the weight of his horse's head on the bridle rein. The beast with dying strength was fighting to get back to that scummy pool, and Bob, a heap in the saddle, was needing all his strength to keep from falling. At the same time, those deadly clear eyes of his took in the bone-white curve of Letchy Welton's jaw, the big rent in Mort Cotton's shirt under the left arm toward the back, the skin showing wet and blistered there, and all the rest in that falling dark, huts partly sunken in blowing sand, wide open door of a deserted blacksmith shop, familiar as a lithograph that had hung in his room for years, wide open door, rusty anvil, sledge standing by, big rusty bear trap in the center of the dirt floor with its half-inch chain running to the base of the anvil, everything sagging and dust-covered. Now Bob was letting himself down out of the saddle, when Lechy's pistol cracked and his voice yelled, "There he goes. I winged him. I got the son of." A second pistol shot, as Letchy dug his spurs into his horse and pressed on the dark street. Bob Leedley and Mort Cotton staggered after him on foot, Bart keeping with them on his pony to the last hut. "It's Palto," they heard the boy say. The young Mexican was on the ground. The point dawning in Bob Leedley's brain was that it would have been so much better, simpler, if one or both of Letchy's shots had finished the job. Palto was down to prey, kneeling on the sand-blown, half-obliterated road. Welton jerked his horse so close, it looked as if he meant to trample the boy before he stepped down. With his boot, he shoved the figure over on its side. "So it was you who did the hammering on old man Batten's skull?" "Yo no, senor." Not a man looking up, but the ashes of a boy, fag and fright all that was left. "Weren't even there, were you? Home in bed all night. Just started out for a morning ride with Margarin and Rueda. Si, senor was there but no kill." Letchy turned his thin smile to the others. "I guess you've heard that. I guess we've got what we came for. I guess we've heard from his own lips, he was one of the three." Bob Leedley wasn't right in his own head, he knew just enough to know that one thing. He saw his son looking down at Palto. He saw, a kind of humor about it, that Bart hadn't mixed in the pursuit with any sacred idea of the law's vengeance. Now the upshot of the whole matter from Letchy Welton. "According to law, we can't finish him here and be done with it. Being still alive, we've got to fix to take him back to where a court is. Only if he should try to escape, we could put a bullet through him, but he won't do that, will you, Palto?" "No, senor," sliding away from Welton's boot. "We aren't the court, and can't hang him here, and there's no shack in this hole of a town that will hold him. Our horses are done for, they won't get back to Bismo." Letchy's words died out of Bob Leedley's ears. He was trying to find himself. He was seeing old Batten's white hair not combed as usual. He was seeing his own boy, a look in Bart's face different from ever before. The hard white curve of Letchy's jaw was before his eyes and words again. "I, for one, ain't sitting up on guard tonight. I'm not asking you fellows to do what I won't do myself." Something was crowding for utterance to Bob Leedley's lips, but Welton's voice kept it from coming clear. They might be here in Red Ante for days, while someone rode back to Bismo for fresh provisions and horses. "He ain't worth it, no greaser is. Only one way, to fix him so he can't get away." Now Bart spoke up, "I'll stand guard over him tonight. I don't feel so done out." The father was glad, in a crippled sort of fashion, glad but afraid. "I guess not," said Letchy. "Wouldn't look so pretty when we got back, to have you tell him you sat rifle up over the prisoner, while we got our beauty sleep back. No, I'm figuring out a different way from what I saw up yonder, just as we broke into town." He meant the blacksmith shop. Bob Leedley saw Mort Cotton standing in the dark like a dirt-stained corpse. It might have been Batten himself. "I won't take part in it," Bob thought. "I ain't marshal to say what's what, but I won't take no part." Bart was looking his way, but Bob didn't turn to meet his son's eyes. "I ain't a man of law," he was thinking. At the same time, he felt Bart's eyes turning to him persistently, but he couldn't look. "I ain't a man of law." The marshal was managing it alone. Bob had been famished riding into town, but the stuff left in his saddlebags tasted like worms to his tongue, and the water as if running out of a sore. Though he was half dead for it, there was no sleep, with that racket from the blacksmith shop down the dirt road of Red Ante. He didn't meet Bart's eyes again. It was as if he had said goodbye to his son for life. Bob had dragged his blankets away from the empty huts, far out on the sand to get beyond the cries, but they were already in his soul, no getting away. Long afterward, lying out there, he heard the sound of a single shot from the direction of the blacksmith shop, the end of all cries. Welton was there before him, Mort Cotton appearing from the side. Palto's troubles were over, Bart missing. It was not until daybreak that the father found a note pinned to his saddle, written by Bart before the shot had been fired. "I guess I don't belong here, Dad. I'll take Palto with me if I can get him loose. Otherwise, well, you'll know. So long for good, Bart." Chapter 1. 30 years late. Arriving when the present century was well started, Elbert Sartwell had now concluded that his was a most untimely birth. For instance, all that war amounted to in his case was the matter of wearing putties to school. The magic of his youth was moreover smothered in a house full of sisters, imprisoned in a sorority house he found himself, all his aching and persistent dreams unexpressed. But the end had come. Elbert had reached decision, so had his father on the same point. They were at odds. It was a matter of grief to the son that for once there could be no compromise. Fall darkness had closed about him, as these things appeared before Elbert's mind with finality. He left his room, followed the long wide hall to the door of his father's dressing room, and knocked. It was the last quarter of an hour before dinner, and the tone of the "come in" was not encouraging, but it didn't occur to Elbert to wait until dinner, and tobacco had combed down his father's tag ends of the day. Mr. Sartwell was standing before his mirrors and did not turn as the hall door opened. Elbert nodded at the reflection. Also, he observed in the glass a look of fresh vexation, which reminded him that his sister Nancy this very afternoon had smashed the fender and left front wheel of the new phaeton. His father had probably just heard about it. The present moment couldn't be worse, but Elbert didn't see how he could back out now with his ultimatum unreported. "I've been thinking it over," he said, "and I can't start to work in the office, at least not now. You see, I've always wanted." "Always wanted," broke in Mr. Sartwell, "always wanted against my better judgment. A house full of always wanteds. How can a man be expected to stand in the midst of six people, always wanting in different directions?" "I hate to be an added trouble to you," Elbert said in his unruffled way, "but there's no use of my trying to go into the business the way I feel. What is it now?" Still addressing the mirror, the younger man outlined with some embarrassment that he hadn't been able to get over his ardor to tackle life on a cattle range. The broad back before him suddenly jerked about. Elbert was held by the first direct look of one whose son has proved a definite disappointment. Many words followed, some heat. "Pack a pair of pistols. Step along out over the real estate ranges and prairie subdivisions. Why, I'm actually ashamed to have to tell you what any kid half your age knows, that there isn't a West anymore, no cattle country, hasn't been for, why, you're only about 30 years late." Also a final sentence as Elbert withdrew, to the effect that if he did go forth, he would have to pay his own car fare out into the fenceless spaces. There was present at dinner that evening one of Sister Nancy's young men friends, who had no dreams of the West whatsoever. The Sartwell family, diminished by recent marriages of two elder daughters, was pulling together socially in spite of internal trouble. Elbert's thoughts were mainly afar on his own problem, but after a time, he couldn't help noticing the art with which the gentleman guest played up to his father. It could be done, Elbert reflected. The two sons-in-law, already connected up, had also gone about it this way. He felt like a crossed stick, a spectator merely in the home dining room. His glance moved from face to face in the soft, creamy light that flowed down through a thin bowl of alabaster hanging from the ceiling. He alone, and only son, lacked a sort of commonplace craft.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.